Kelly wanted me to announce, she forgot to tell you ladies, read the first chapter of the book, right, by Thursday, because that's what you'll be discussing Thursday. I also forgot to announce Addison Florence Ann Law is here today for her first time ever outside the womb in Lynn Friends Church. She's a beautiful little healthy baby girl. I think I heard the Lion King song. Hallelujah. I just want to talk about a verse today. I was reading this verse, and it's in Zechariah 8:23, and Zechariah is prophesying about when Israel will be restored and all this stuff. But as I read this one verse, it just stuck with me. And this is what it says. It's from the Message Bible, so it might be a little different. I don't think we have a Message Bible up there on the computer. But it says, "Thus says the Lord of hosts, in those days 10 men from every language of the nations shall grab the sleeve of a Jewish man, saying, 'Let us go with you, for we have heard that God is with you.'" And when I read that, I thought, man, what would it look like for me to live a life that people would grab my sleeve to follow me because they know that God is with me? I started thinking about this thought. You know, what would I have in my life for people to follow me because they know God is with me? And if we look at the leaders of the Bible, you know, all through the Bible, Abraham, Moses, you know, Joshua, Caleb, David, Daniel, Jesus, Paul, they all had certain characteristics in their life that were common. Things that drew people to them and allowed people to follow them. It made people want to follow them as leaders. And the number one similarity in all of these men is that they had a hunger for God's presence. Abraham was so close to God that the Bible says that he was God's friend. Moses spent time in God's presence, and God spoke to him, and he saw the presence of God with his very own eyes. Joshua would go into the tabernacle with Moses, and when Moses would finish doing his things, he would leave. And the Bible says that Joshua would not leave because he loved the presence of God. David said that one day in God's house is better than 1,000 anywhere else. Jesus spent many nights alone in prayer up on the mountainside. We know that Paul spent 3 years being taught by the Holy Spirit after his conversion. And all these heroes of the faith, they love being in God's presence. They love spending time with him. Do we have a hunger for his presence? Anyone throughout history who has ever done great things for God's kingdom has had a hunger and a desire for his presence. But as we look at these men and think about these guys in the Bible, there's other characteristics that draw people to them. So if we want people to grab our sleeve, we would do well to put these things in our own lives and apply them too. So another one we're going to look at this morning is holiness. Holy is the word hagios, and it means sacred, physically pure, or morally blameless. It's used in 1 Peter 1:13 through 16. "Therefore, with minds that are alert and fully sober, set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus Christ is revealed at his coming. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance, but just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, 'Be holy because I am holy.'" So if we think about holiness, you know, we see there that it's an action. We see there that we're responsible for something. Because the Bible says to be holy. But to start out in holiness, there's nothing we can do in our own power to be made holy. There's nothing we can do to be made morally blameless. That's only through the blood of Jesus that we can be made pure and holy. But that doesn't give us a free rein to do whatever we want. After we accept that gift, that doesn't give us a free rein to do whatever we want and just to keep applying that blood to our lives. We have to have a change. We have to a responsibility in this holiness. And as I was thinking about it, I was thinking of the example of a shower. You know, what would happen if you would get into your shower, but you didn't turn the water on? You wouldn't, you know, if you stepped out, you wouldn't be real clean, right? Even if you turn the water on, you know, you still have to apply soap. You have to apply soap and water to your body to be clean. And that's the same concept with the blood of Christ. You know, we have to apply that blood of Christ to our lives to be washed clean. But after we get out of the shower and we're clean, there's things we can do to stay clean, right? Like, you don't hop out of the shower and then go out and work in the yard or go exercise or, you know, whatever you do to get dirty. You don't do those things right after you get out of the shower because you want to stay clean, right? Well, when we apply the blood of Christ to our lives, we have a responsibility to maintain that holiness, to maintain that cleanness. We have to stay out of the dirt of the world. Jesus or Peter said, "Be holy because I am holy." So be holy in all you do. It's an action. It's something that we have to be responsible for. We have that choice to stay holy and set apart and pure. They asked James this question, and James 2:17, he answered, he said, "What is a prophet, my brother? And if someone says he has faith but does not have works, can faith save him? If a brother or sister is naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you says to them, 'Depart in peace, be warmed and filled,' but you do nothing to give them the things that are needed for the body, what does it profit? Thus also, faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. Someone will say, 'You have faith and I have works.' But Peter says, 'Show me your faith by your works, and I will show you my faith by my works.'" We have to have works. We have to have a follow-up to our holiness, to the holiness that Jesus gives us. Yes, we're saved through the blood of Jesus. There's no denying that. Only through his blood alone are we made pure and holy. But the evidence of us receiving that sacrifice is the way we live our lives. The way we live our lives is going to reflect that holiness that Jesus has given us. It's our job to do our very best to maintain that holiness. We have to guard what we watch, what we listen to, protect our minds from the garbage of the world, protect our hearts from offense and bitterness. We have to be careful who we hang around. I used to preach this scripture every week to my youth kids. 1 Corinthians 15 says, "Do not be misled. Bad company corrupts good morals." It's not even an issue. Bad company corrupts good morals. The Bible says it in black and white. And we have to protect our holiness. We have to guard our holiness. And we have a responsibility to walk in that holiness. So if we want people to grab our sleeve because they know God is with us, we have to live the life of holiness. Now, the second thing that's evident in all these guys' lives is righteousness. And the word righteous is the Greek word dikaios. And it means innocent in character or action. To stand out among the crowd, our characters and our actions have to be innocent and just and pure. And all throughout the Bible, we can see followers of God who stood out because of their righteousness. In Genesis 7, we see God tell Noah to go into the ark that he built to save him and his family because Noah was found righteous in the eyes of God. Again, it was an action. It was something that Noah did. He lived a righteous life. The Bible says that Noah was blameless before people and he walked faithfully with God. He was righteous because of the life he lived. In James 2, he talks about Abraham, and it said Abraham was considered righteous when he was obedient by offering his son as a sacrifice. Knowing that God didn't accept human sacrifice, he knew that God would provide a way, and it was counted to him as righteousness because he walked in obedience. David says this about himself in Psalms 18, verse 20 through 24. It says, "The Lord hath dealt with me according to my righteousness. According to my cleanness of my hands, he has rewarded me. For I have kept the ways of the Lord. I am not guilty of turning from my God. All his laws are before me. I have not turned away from his decrees. I have been blameless before him and kept myself from sin. The Lord has rewarded me according to my righteousness, according to the cleanness of my hands in his sight." And we can see this all time and time again throughout the Bible. All these guys. It wasn't that they were perfect. You know, Romans says that we have all sinned and come short of the glory of God. These guys are no different. They have sinned, but they still had a choice in the way they act. They had a choice in the way that we treat people. We can decide if we're going to live that life of integrity and righteousness. We decide what our character is going to look like. No one else does that for us. We have to decide who are we going to be. Are we going to stand out among the crowd? Look at some of the things the Bible says about righteousness. In 1 John 2:28, "And now, children, stay with Christ, live deeply in Christ. Then we'll be ready for him when he appears, ready to receive him with open arms, with no cause for red-faced guilt or lame excuses when he arrives. Once you're convinced that he is right and righteous, you'll recognize that all who practice righteousness are God's true children." Proverbs 12:28 says, "In the way of righteousness there is life." Proverbs 21:21 says, "Whoever pursues righteousness and love finds life and prosperity and honor." James 2:24 said, "You see that a person is considered righteous by what they do and not faith alone." We have a responsibility in the way we act. We have a responsibility to live a righteous life. Are we living a righteous life? Are our lives innocent in character and action? If we want someone to be grabbing our sleeves, we have to live a righteous life, and we have to be holy. The third one, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on the third one. It's But it's to be honorable. We talked about this in a 3 or 4 week series, so but I just wanted to hit on it real quick, because this the honor was in every part of everybody's life throughout the Bible. And this Greek word timeo, it means to pop, to prize, to fix a value upon, to revere. We have to value people. We have to revere God. And we just finished this, so like I said, I don't want to hit a lot on it and rehash everything, but people notice when you live a life of honor. When you put others first, people notice that. You know, when we honor people because of that's who we are, and not because who they are, it attracts people to Jesus because they see something different in us. They see something that the world doesn't have. We have to live that life of honor. Another one is love. We have to live a life of love. And there's many words in the Greek, in the Bible, that talk about love. But agape is the main one, and it's a love that is an affection. It's a love feast. They actually consider it a love. They used to have feasts that they would just get together and love on each other. Wouldn't that be amazing? Kind of like our dinners up there, you know. It's just food and fun. Food, fun, and friends, and love one another. I'm always up for that. That's awesome. But we have to show love to one another. And I'm not going to hit a lot on this either because, you know, we talked about a lot about love one another and stuff in the previous weeks. But the Bible gives a pretty good definition of what love is in 1 Corinthians 13. It says, if I speak in the tongues of men or angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and I can fathom all the mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith that can move mountains, but I don't have love, I am nothing. That's a bold statement. It goes on to say, if I give all that I have to the poor, if I give my body over to hardships that I might boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but it rejoices with the truth. It always protects. It always trusts. It always hopes. It always perseveres. Love never fails. Man, a lot of times when I'm going through hard times, I'll get that verse out and I'll just mirror my life and I'll think, all right, am I doing this? Because that's hard. It's hard to live a life in this world today and apply all those things to yourself as you try to love one another. But man, if we do it, it's so rewarding. So rewarding. If people want to see God in your life and follow you, you have to be loving and honorable and righteous and holy. Another thing is kindness. We have to be kind to one another. And the Greek word here is Philadelphia. Not the city that just won the Super Bowl and won me a steak dinner. Oh, wait, Jeremy's not in here. Darn it. Philadelphia, brotherly love is the translation. Love for fellow believers. The quality of being friendly, generous, and considerate. Sometimes it's not always easy to be kind to others, right? We know that. We all picture that person, and of course in our eyes, that you just want to give a five-finger throat punch to death, you know. But do I? That's right, in the name of Jesus. What's it called? The hand of fellowship? Sometimes it's not always easy to be nice to these people. But the Bible calls us to crucify the flesh every day. We're called to live a life that's different. We're called to live by the Spirit. We all have people in our lives that it's hard to deal with, but we also have people in our lives that are easy to deal with. You know, so we all have friends that we can be kind to because they're like us, right? But people that are different, people that aren't like us, we have different characters and different ideas. Sometimes it's a little harder, and you just have to choose. Just be kind. You just have to choose it. And a lot of times when you do that, it just feels better. I remember this fellow that went to my old church, and he was you know mentally ill, and he you know from birth, you know, and every Sunday morning when they started coming, he would just you know come up to me and just follow me like a little puppy dog, and I would begin trying to get ready. I would have to greet people and get my announcements ready and get all this stuff ready. I just got done with Sunday school, and he would just follow me around, just talking nonstop. You know, even when I was greeting somebody, he would be behind me telling me about the weather, you know, or the sports team or whatever, you know, whatever was on his mind that day. And it got to a point where I was getting irritated, and I had to make a decision, because this fella just wanted a friend. He just needed somebody to be nice to him, and I continued to be nice to him where, you know, other people would tell him, hey, you know, I got to go do this, you know, and he would be left standing there by himself. And I'll never forget the day we left. Might make me cry. But he came up to me on our last Sunday, and he just had tears streaming down his face. And I'm not exactly sure, you couldn't understand him talking all the time, you know, you couldn't understand what he said all the time, but the basic gist of it was that he was just telling me how much he was going to miss me and how much he loved me. And it broke my heart, you know. And I didn't see him do that to anybody else anytime, you know, just because I chose to be kind to him. Even when I was irritated, even though I had other things to do, I chose to be kind to him. Ephesians 4:31 says, "Get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, brawling, slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as Christ God forgave you." 2 Peter 1:5 says, "For this very reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, and to goodness knowledge, to knowledge self-control, and to self-control perseverance, to perseverance godliness, and to godliness mutual affection, and to mutual affection love. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. Whoever does not have them is nearsighted and blind, forgetting that they have been cleansed from their past sins." My hope and prayer is that none of us are ever ineffective and unproductive in our pursuit of Christ. If you don't hear anything else that I say this morning, please remember this. Be kind to people. Be kind to everyone. We don't know what people are going through. We don't know the battles they face. Be kind. Kindness will go farther than any other thing in our witness for Jesus Christ. Be kind. Another thing I want to talk about that we can see evidence in these lives is selflessness. Having or showing great concern for other people and little or no concern of yourself. Jesus told this story one time about this Jewish man that he was traveling down the road from Jerusalem to Jericho, and on his way, these robbers caught him and beat him, and they robbed him and left him for dead. They left him in the ditch, thinking he was dead. And by chance, a priest walked by, a worker at the temple, a Jewish priest, and he came by and he looked at him. And he went to the other side of the road and passed him by and didn't stop and help. A little bit later, Levi, who was another religious leader, came walking down the road. And he looked at him, beaten and almost dead, and he went by on the other side of the road. A few minutes later, a Samaritan passed by. A Samaritan was an enemy of the Jews. The Jews and the Samaritans didn't like each other. They thought that they were each chosen by God to be his special nation. But the Samaritan, who normally didn't like Jews, saw him laying in the ditch, almost dead, and he had compassion on him, the Bible says. And he took him, and he bandaged his wounds, and he set him on his own donkey, and he took him to the next town, and he took him to the inn, and he took care of him to make sure he would be okay. And the next day, the Bible says that he left the innkeeper 2 denarii to take care of this guy and pay for him to stay there and get better. And we know that a denarii was worth a day's wage. So this guy just didn't throw a $20 bill. He gave 2 days' wages for this guy to help him. And he said, "If there's anything else I owe, I'll come back and I'll pay for it. You can trust me." And as Jesus posed this question, he said, "Which one of these guys was selfless?" And, you know, they all easily said, you know, the Samaritan, right? You know, and we would be correct to say that. The Samaritan was the one that was selfless. But if we look at this story a little deeper, things are going on in this story that's a little more than what we just see on the surface. This wasn't a story about two church workers that were just jerks and uncompassionate. These two church workers, this priest and this Levite, they were temple workers. They were probably on their way to the temple to do their jobs. They were on their way to do their sacrifices or teach or whatever else they did there. So if they looked at this man, and if they knew that if he was beaten and bloody and almost dead, if they touched him, they would be unclean. They would be ceremonially unclean for 7 days. So as they looked at him, they knew that if they were unclean, they couldn't do their job in the temple. They couldn't pray for people. They couldn't offer sacrifices. If they were unclean, they couldn't touch their family. They couldn't touch their children. They couldn't give their kids a kiss goodnight. If they were unclean, every time they went out into the world, they would have to announce that they were unclean. So when they passed by this man, they looked at him and they started weighing the cost. Man, is it worth it for me to help him? Because if I help him, I won't be able to do all this stuff. If I help him, I'm going to be unclean for 7 days. If I help him, I'm not going to be able to do my job. If I help him, I'm going to have to be embarrassed because I'm going to be unclean. If I help him, I'm going to have to go through town and announce that I'm unclean. If I help him, people are going to start rumors about me. Why is he unclean? And they considered the cost, and they thought that it wasn't worth it to help the man out. So they went on their way. They were more concerned with their religiousness than they were with helping this man. We can't get so involved with stuff, even if it's church stuff, even if it's ministry stuff. We can't get so involved in those things that we forget about ministering to people. People are the most important thing to the kingdom of God. Reaching people for Jesus Christ is always the goal. Everything we do in life should point to Jesus. It doesn't matter if we're working. It doesn't matter if we're playing sports. It doesn't matter if we're shopping at Walmart or getting gas at the gas station. Everything we do should point to Jesus. We should be a reflection of who he is. We have to conduct ourselves in such a way that when people look at us, they grab our sleeve because they know that God is with us. And they want what we have. We have to make the gospel attractive. Titus 2:10 says, so that in every way we will make the teaching about God our Savior attractive. That's the goal for us to live. Are we making the gospel attractive to the world around us? Do the people around us on a daily basis even know that we follow Christ? Are we living a holy lifestyle that God has called us to? Are we clothed in his righteousness? Do we show honor to everyone that comes around us? Are we showing those around us the same love that God has shown us? Are we kind to people, even when they get on our nerves? Are we following Christ's example of being selfless? Are we pursuing his presence? Zechariah 8:23 says, in that day, men will grab the sleeve of a godly man and say, let us go with you, because we know God is with you. So I challenge you this week, look inward at your life. Are we being a reflection of Christ to those around us? Or are we showing the world around us who Jesus really is? Are we living a life that makes the gospel of Jesus Christ attractive? Is anyone grabbing our sleeve because they know that God is with us? Let's bow our heads and pray. Father, we thank you for this day. Lord, we thank you for your word and that we can look at it and see what you expect from us. God, we can see the ways you want us to live our lives. We can see, Lord God, these things that you've called us to be. You've called us to be holy. You've called us to be righteous. God, you've called us to love one another and honor one another and be kind. God, you've called us to these things, and you expect us, God, to walk in these characteristics. But God, we're human, and we fail, and we're not perfect. So God, I pray, Lord, that we would just set this in our mind, Father, that this would be our goal. God, to put these things into our lives, to allow them to grow in our lives, Father, so that when people see us, they can see who you really are. Father, we love you so much. We thank you, God, for the free gift you've given us. And I pray, God, that we would take that and use it, Father, and show the world who you are. Because that's what's going to bring people to you. We love you so much, God. In your precious name we pray. Amen.
Please stand and join us as we close.